on to our second module, decision making. And just like pre-flight planning, decision making can impact on us having a successful flight. So what are some of the traps to decision making? First of all, bias. There's many different types of bias. And one that comes to mind is the halo effect, for example. Now, the halo effect is one that can be described only as putting maybe someone up on a pedestal because of maybe their experience or who they are as an individual. I like to use the example of Chuck Yeager, for example. So if I went and asked Chuck Yeager a flying question about something about maybe a modern aircraft and flying that aircraft now, I might take his example or his advice really highly because of his experience and what I know about him as a pilot. But then again, I might ask that same question of a brand new grade 2 flying instructor. Now, that flying instructor may not have that same experience as Chuck Yeager, but they're a lot more current. And maybe I need to be listening to them rather than that person that I've put up on a pedestal under that halo bias. The second one is time pressures. So we talked about time pressures playing into our planning and maybe preventing us from planning. It also plays into our decision making, and it can work both ways. As you know, when we're under pressure and time is of the essence, maybe we don't make effective decisions because we don't have enough time to think about what we need. When we're put under time pressure, maybe we don't have the time to really think through all of the areas that we need to consider. But on the other hand, time can also play in the fact that we have too much time. When we have too much time to consider something, maybe we're taking in too many different options that we then get mixed up in all of those extra things that we're thinking about, rather than maybe selecting a few particular items. Fatigue. As we all know, we don't think as well when we're tired. Solving the wrong problem. We've seen plenty of examples over the years of solving the wrong problem. In Miami, for example, in the Everglades, there was an aircraft during the 1970s of an aircraft that had a light bulb for indicating its undercarriage, and that light bulb wasn't illuminating when the aircraft came into land. As a result, the flight crew ended up holding for quite a significant time, but inadvertently actually knocked the autopilot off and ended up crashing prior to actually arrival. And it wasn't that the undercarriage wasn't down, it was the fact that the light bulb was actually blown. And therefore you can see us solving potentially the wrong problem. Failure to consult. Who do we actually have available to us to discuss some of the problems that are going on in our cockpit? Now, it's not so bad when we have multi-crews, or maybe we're actually out flying with our pilot friend. Sometimes maybe our passengers may actually think of something that we haven't considered as part of our problem solving. But what about when we're actually flying on our own? Are there resources or people that we can consult when we're out in those particular areas? So I think of other parties such as air traffic control or other pilots on the area frequency that maybe if I'm in some sort of problem, I might be able to utilize them as a resource to consult. And the last one is complacency. And I think we covered off complacency as part of our failure to plan earlier. It's that, I can't be bothered kind of thing. So we're going to look at tools, just like we did in flight planning, that we can use as part of our decision making. And the tool that we're going to use is called Pilot. And as part of using this tool, we're actually going to use a case study or a scenario that we've already looked at. And the case study that we're going to use is the aircraft flying from Portapunkah in Victoria through to Parafield in South Australia. So let's walk through the pilot model and understand what it actually means. So P standing for pooling the facts. I is identifying the problem. L is looking for solutions. O is to operate. T is to take stock. And when you think about this, we almost do this intuitively. You think about the aviate, navigate, communicate. You can almost apply this to the pilot model. And for those of you that are familiar with decision-making models, you may be familiar with terms such as A grade or decide, which use similar principles to the pilot model. So let's break the pilot model down a little bit further. Pull the facts. What is our current situation? What is actually going on around us that we know of? Identifying the problem. What is actually the problems that are in front of me? And it doesn't necessarily just have to be one. What are the multiple problems that exist and how do I prioritize them? L is look for solutions. Given the current information, what can I devise as a plan and take action on? O, operate. Now I'm actually applying the plan. I'm putting it into action. And the last one, and maybe I will take back the word last one, is take stock. Has your plan changed since the situation started? Now, the reason why I say I don't like to make it the last one is, as you will see by the diagram in front of you, is that this planning model is actually very cyclic. Once you start and you put an action in play, it may actually change the situation in front of you, and therefore you need to re-pull the facts and work back through the problem again. We're going to apply the pilot module to the case study that we saw in the planning module, where the aircraft flew from Portapunka in Victoria to Parafield in South Australia, and we had a fuel issue along the way. So now we can pull the facts. The aircraft departed behind schedule up to 90 minutes. The aircraft potentially arriving after last light limited their landing areas and ability to be able to get fuel. Diversions and descent due to cloud and weather created more flight time and potential more use of fuel. Lower altitude, the headwind that the aircraft encountered in the initial phase of flight and which had been planned for was only 10 knots, but the aircraft had actually encountered 20 to 25 knot headwind toward the end of the flight. And the last available fuel for the aircraft was at nil, and the decision to overfly based on that information at the time. So if we move on to the I, we need to identify what the problems were as part of those facts. And these can be multiple problems, and we'll prioritise them. The late departure meant that last light occurred before the aircraft could get to Murray Bridge. No lights at that particular airfield meant that they were unable to refuel there. The higher fuel burn due to the lower level and weather avoidance since nil, that they took some time to actually get identified by ATC and they were asked to remain OCTA for a significant period of time. They had insufficient fuel to be able to conduct their flight to Parafield. And that's probably the main problem that we can identify here. And that's why we've put the asterisk at the end. So let's move to our L in the pilot model, looking for solutions. Now, there are many solutions that can be used here. However, we've just chosen a select few. They're not necessarily the best solutions, but they're used as an example. So one is to advise ATC of their fuel situation. And while they made a pan call, under the current rules, that would be making a mayday call. The earlier the call is made means that ATC can provide assistance earlier and maybe some track shortening or some priority. Ask for assistance in locating alternate landing areas, configuring the aircraft for maximum range, and considering a change of course due to lower terrain. So if we move on from looking for solutions, now we want to pick one of those solutions and we want to operate, putting one of those into play. So in this particular circumstance, we've chosen to fly the aircraft and configure it for maximum range. Continue high to Adelaide to give us best glide ability. And lastly, but as I said, it's not necessarily last if we're looking at our cyclic model, is to take stock. How has our situation changed? Keep the normal in the abnormal situation. Now, some of you might ask what that actually means. So for most of us, we have regular checks that we conduct throughout our flight. But sometimes when we've encountered some abnormal situations, some of those things aren't necessarily at the forefront of our brain. When we come into land, maybe we might run through a bump checklist, or maybe if we're flying a retractable aircraft, that our undercarriage is in fact down when we're configuring our aircraft on final. That is keeping the normal in the abnormal by continuing to conduct those checks. Or in maybe this circumstance where the aircraft was landing after dark, is ensuring that we've activated the PAL. And then, as I said earlier, has my situation improved by taking the actions that I have? Or has it actually changed my situation, and do I need to consider further actions? Most of the items that we've covered in the pilot model are fairly intuitive, and you probably conduct these things without even knowing it. All we've done there is take the opportunity to break it down and make you think about each of those particular steps for next time that you go flying.